Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Good morning, everyone. Lovely to see you this morning. I want to welcome you to this service of Holy Communion on this first Sunday in Lent. It's great that we're able again to celebrate the Lord's Supper with each other. This morning, we'll also be continuing our series on Ezra-Nehemiah as we walk through those books. We come from scattered lives to meet with God, so let's share a moment or two of silence as we begin and recognize that the living God is with us. Let's be still in His presence. James reminds us that every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. So let's worship this faithful, good God in our opening hymn. It's hymn number 80, Great is Thy Faithfulness, 80, as we stand to sing. going to remain standing, but if that's uncomfortable for you, because we'll be standing for the next few minutes, then just be comfortable and sit, no problems whatsoever. If you can turn to page 201 in our Green Book of Common Prayer, page 125 if you're using the large print. And let's join together in the Collect for Purity. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And as we are in Lent, could you turn to page 222, page 147, if you're using the large print. We're going to speak out the Ten Commandments together. You'll see that the commandments are written in block capitals, and I'll speak those out, but if you could respond, please, with the New Testament reaffirmation of each. And we do that to remember the standards that God calls us to before we move into the time of confession and forgiveness, because forgiveness is freely offered by our God. But let's first of all remember the standards that he calls us to. So hear these commandments which God has given to his people. Take them to heart. I am the Lord your God. You shall have no other gods but me. You shall not make for yourself any idol. You shall not dishonor the name of the Lord your God. Remember the Lord's day and keep it holy. Together, Lord, have mercy on us and write these your laws in our hearts. Honor your father and your mother. You shall not commit murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not be a false witness. You shall not covet anything which belongs to your neighbor. Have mercy on us and write these your laws in our hearts. And then we remember that God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to intercede for us in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. So let us sit or kneel to confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace. Can you turn with me, please, to the penitential Kyries on page 227 of our prayer books? Page 227. In the wilderness, we find your grace. You love us with an everlasting love. Lord, have mercy. There is none but you to uphold our cause. Our sin cries out and our guilt is great. Christ, have mercy. Heal us, O Lord, and we shall be healed. Restore us and we shall know your joy. Lord, have mercy. We continue in prayer using the Collect for the first Sunday in Lent. Almighty and everlasting God, you hate nothing that you have made, and forgive the sins of all those who are penitent. Create and make in us new and contrite hearts, that we, worthily lamenting our sins and acknowledging our wretchedness, may receive from you, the God of all mercy, perfect remission and forgiveness, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Andy's going to bring us our first Bible reading. Thanks, Andy.
Our first reading comes from Nehemiah chapter 5. Now the men and their wives raised a great outcry against their fellow Jews. Some were saying, "We and our sons and daughters are numerous. In order for us to eat and stay alive, we must get grain." Others were saying, "We are mortgaging our fields, our vineyards, and our homes to get grain during the famine." Still others were saying, "We have had to borrow money to pay the king's tax on our fields and vineyards. Although we are of the same flesh and blood as our fellow Jews, and though our children are as good as theirs, yet we have to subject our sons and daughters to slavery. Some of our daughters have already been enslaved, but we are powerless, because our fields and our vineyards belong to others." When I heard their outcry and these charges, I was very angry. I pondered them in my mind and I accused the nobles and officials. I told them, "You are charging your own people interest." So I called together a large meeting to deal with them and said, "As far as possible, we have bought back our fellow Jews who were sold to the Gentiles. Now you are selling your own people, only for them to be sold back to us." They kept quiet because they could find nothing to say. So I continued, "What you are doing is not right. Shouldn't you walk in the fear of our God to avoid the reproach of our Gentile enemies? I and my brothers and my men are also lending the people money and grain. But let us stop charging interest. Give back to them immediately their fields, vineyards, olive groves and houses, and also the interest you are charging them. 1% of the money, grain, new wine, and olive oil." "We will give it back," they said, "and we will not demand anything more from them. We will do as you say." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Andy. We're going to turn to our red hymn books and hymn number 349 and stand to sing, "Fill Thou My Life, O Lord, My God," hymn 349. We remain standing. Hear the gospel of our Savior Christ according to Luke chapter 4, beginning at verse 1. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them he was hungry. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone." The devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, "I will give you all their authority and splendor. It has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want to. If you worship me, it will be yours." Jesus answered, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." The devil led him to Jerusalem and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus answered, "It is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. And as we remain standing, we turn to the words of the Nicene Creed, page 205 in our prayer books, page 129 in the large print. Let's speak out our faith in the words of the Nicene. We believe. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And so, living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as we turn now to your word, we pray that you would speak to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take our seats. So as you know, we are continuing through Ezra, and now we're in the book of Nehemiah, and we're particularly focusing, there's lots of angles you could take as you look at these books, but we're particularly focusing on how God is restoring his people. There's building work going on, like our building work that's gone on. They're rebuilding the temple, they're rebuilding the walls, but in all of that, God is rebuilding them. And that's our prayer, that God would build us up in our faith. Last week, we looked at how we are called to work together effectively for God. And we saw that all of us are involved in God's work. There's no exceptions. All of us are in this. All of us are integral to what God wants to do here. That we need to look out for each other and work together. That we need to be faithful where God has placed us. So think about your home. Think about your neighbors. Think about if you're working your workplace. Those are the primary places where God has placed you. And we're called there to serve him and to see his kingdom come. And then fourthly, last week, we were called to be faithful, to keep at it, to finish what God has called us to do until he moves us on, even if what he's called us to do isn't particularly glamorous. Do you remember the guys who are rebuilding the dung gate? So it is with us. Sometimes the work isn't particularly glamorous, but God calls us to be faithful in whatever he's called us to do. Now, if Disney was writing the story based on last week and what we saw last week, if Disney was writing the story this week, we would expect it to say something like, "And so they went out and they sung Kumbaya from morning to night, and the walls were rebuilt and they all lived happily ever after." Cue music, fireworks, everything. Beautiful. But instead, what we see in chapter 5 and in chapters 4 and 6 are different types of opposition. That word raises its head again. So in chapters 4 and 6, there's opposition from without, but the chapter we've just read, Andy read to us, chapter 5, it's opposition from within. Our reading shows how the people had to deal with conflict from within themselves. And the question I want us to ask ourselves today is, what happens when the things that we were talking about last week, that calling to work together effectively, what happens when that goes wrong? When things get difficult, when there's a wee bit of friction between us, those sort of things, what are we meant to do? I wonder if you've ever experienced that in church life, a little bit of friction. Anybody? I'm sure you have. We're people. Well, there's much that we can learn from today's reading. And we'll get on to that in a second. First of all, a little bit of an explanation for the issue that has arose. So we have these returning exiles, and they're completely focused on rebuilding the wall. So those who would otherwise be earning an income by working, or working on their farms and producing food, those people are completely involved in the project and so are unable to do those other things. The result is that families are struggling to feed themselves. There's hunger in the camp. But more than that, if you look at the passage, you'll see in verse 4 that the Persian king, do you remember they're still under Persian rule? The Persian king is levying a tax against the people that's very high. It's crippling them, the level of the tax from Persia. And on top of all of that, we're told in verse 3 that there's a general famine in the land. Food is generally scarce anyway. So all these things taken together meant that the Jewish people are desperate to find means and ways of feeding their families. As a result, they had to resort to doing what so many in the world do. They had to resort to remortgaging their fields, remortgaging their vineyards in order to get a little bit of money together. They also approached some of their more well-to-do fellow Jews for help. And some of these Jews lent them money at a reasonable level of interest or no interest, but some of them lent them money at exorbitant levels of interest, even though they were their fellow countrymen. With the result that some of the Jewish children were being sold into slavery to other Jews. So you can imagine, it's no surprise that the first verse of chapter 5, we're told, the men and their wives raised a great outcry against their fellow Jews. You would too, if you were in that situation. When Nehemiah heard what was going on, he knew that he needed to take urgent action. So he stops the work on the walls in order to try to get things resolved. Now, dissension and discord within the body of Christ isn't something that we can just sort of hope goes away. It is something that has really serious ramifications. It's something that we need to deal with. We know it's serious because Jesus specifically prayed for unity among his church, among the people in his church. He prayed that we would love one another. He prayed there would be unity among us. So you can see how important it is to God and in the heart of God that we get on and that we love and that we cooperate and that we're interdependent. That's not to say that we should never criticize. We should criticize constructively, and some of you do that really well. You come to me and say, I'm not so happy with this. For these reasons, this is how we could fix it. Brilliant. That's superb. That's what we need to do always. But there's a difference between that and fomenting conflict, spreading gossip, stoking up discord and dissension. Do you see the difference? And that's the thing that Nehemiah was speaking against. That's what he was needing to deal with. So what are the biblical principles we can learn from Nehemiah as we try to build together? What principles can we learn for dealing with conflict that comes up among us? And these are principles that you can use for any conflict. Conflict's sort of all over the place, isn't it? Particularly in the news at the moment. These are principles that you can use in any conflict, but particularly thinking about conflict as we seek to build together. First thing that struck me is that Nehemiah responds holistically. That's a very in word at the moment, but it's an important word. Many times when we hit a conflict, we respond on only one level, and so our response is limited or even unsatisfactory. But Nehemiah approached this problem with his heart, with his mind, and with his will. I'll show you that in a second. Holistically, with his heart, with his mind, and with his will. First of all, he responds emotionally. If you look at verse 6, we're told, Nehemiah says, when I heard their outcry and these charges, I was very angry. When I heard the outcry and what was going on, I was very angry. I don't know how you respond to that. We've talked about this before, so it's no surprise. You know that the Bible says that anger is not a sin in and of itself. We know this because Paul writes, in your anger, do not sin. So in other words, you can have anger without sinning. And also that Jesus is described as having a righteous anger in the temple. Both those things show us that anger is possible without sinning. But we need to be very careful, because most of us are very quick to justify ourselves. I know I am. And sometimes we imagine that our anger is righteous when it's anything but righteous. So we say, I'm fully justified to be feeling like this and acting in this way, when we're not. But there is a time to be angry. And that time is when we see injustice, the exploitation of the vulnerable, when we see people flouting God's guidelines, guidelines that are given to us for our protection and for society's protection. When we see those things, then it's right for a righteous anger to rise up in us. And my question to us is, do you ever get angry? When you look around the world and see the horrendous injustices that are meted out on some people, do you ever get angry? Does something rise up in you and say, this is not right? Because it should. It's part of what we're called. It's part of God's likeness in us. There's no point, though, in getting roused up to anger and then doing nothing about it, because that just leaves us frustrated. So how else can we respond? He responds emotionally. He also responds intellectually. If you look at verse 7, we're told by Nehemiah that I pondered the charges made by those who were being exploited. I pondered them in my mind. Nehemiah takes time to think about the situation. He doesn't go off angry and half-cocked. Do you ever get angry and then just go, bleh? Anybody? Some people are being daubed in here. Do you ever just respond on the cusp, just as soon as it happens, you just respond in anger, not thought through? Oftentimes when we do that, we end up hurting somebody we love, and causing damage with our words or our actions that's really hard to repair. Do you know the Bible says two things that we're to be slow about? We're to be slow to speak. We're to be slow also to anger. And we're to be slow to speak. Slow to anger, slow to speak. Is that what we're like? Whenever something happens that causes us to anger, do we pause and consider and think through how we're going to respond and then do it in a thought-through way? Or do we respond sometimes and end up making the situation worse? Nehemiah took the time to think before he responded. So he responds emotionally, he responds intellectually, but then he responds with his will, with action. Having been stirred to anger, having thought through his response, what he does is he takes action directly at source. So in verse 7, we're told, I pondered these things in my mind, and then I accused the nobles and officials. I told them, you are charging your own people interest. Nehemiah goes right to the offending parties. This is really important. What he doesn't do is gossip to his friends about what's going on. What he doesn't do is send a wee phone call or an email and say, you know your man, he's done it again. You know your woman, listen to what she's done. He goes straight to the offending parties and talks directly, first of all, to them. Let's talk a wee bit about confrontation. Most of us find confrontation difficult, yes? I find confrontation difficult. Some people seem to relish it, but most of us find it difficult. But you know, on occasions, confrontation is really necessary. It's a necessary thing. Confrontation, as we see in the screen there, is a positive way to handle negative events. For example, let me give you an example. In a group, the whole group can be damaged because one person is behaving in a way that is detrimental to the group. You've seen that, yes? So the whole group suffers because people won't confront that one person and say, actually, the way you're doing things isn't helpful here. It's not helping us. And confronting it, and we'll see how we confront positively in a little while. But that's one reason why confronting is a good idea. But secondly, confrontation is important because what happens if you leave something? If you leave it, usually it festers, doesn't it? And usually you're in a much worse situation a few months down the road because you didn't confront it in the right way at that time. So for those reasons and more, confrontation is important. The point is not whether we confront people, but as Christians, how we confront people. And Nehemiah again shows us some principles for this. Confront literally means to stand in front of, to stand face to face with face. So it means to face up to someone. We have this expression in our culture, to get in the face of. That's the wrong way to confront. But you can confront someone, be face to face with them, in a way that's not antagonistic, in a way that's not hostile, in a way that is loving and helpful rather than pushing them back and blaming. This is what Nehemiah does. He appeals to the nobles on many different levels. In verse 9, he says to them, listen, what you're doing isn't right. Shouldn't, it's a great word, shouldn't you walk in the fear of our God to avoid the reproach of our Gentile enemies? He appeals to their better nature. He knows that they're part of God's family, and he appeals and calls that out from them. He doesn't just say, look at all you're doing wrong. He appeals to the positive and calls that out from them. God, remember, had set apart the people of Israel to be an example, to show God's goodness to others. And the principal way in which they showed God's goodness to others was how they loved each other, was how they got on. And we too should do the right thing for two reasons. One, because it's the right thing and we want to honor God, but also that we too are called to display God's love to those around us. Do you remember what Jesus said in John 13? A new commandment, a new guideline? No. A new, you could try this if you want? No. A new what? A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. And what is the reason Jesus gives that they should love one another? Does anyone remember? Was it just so you feel nice and everybody's nice and we can all get on nicely? No, he goes on to say, this is a commandment that you love one another. By this shall all men know that you follow me, that you're my disciples. Isn't that interesting? The way we love each other, the way we get on, is evangelistic in nature. People look at how we get on or should do, and they say, that's brilliant. That's great. I want to be part of that. I want to be part of that community. Look how they love each other. Look how they look out for each other. Look how they work together effectively. And they're drawn in. Jesus says, love one another, because by this shall all men know that you follow me. So when faced with friction and discord, Nehemiah responds holistically, emotions, intellect, and action. He confronts at source, not in an antagonistic way, but rather by appealing to their better side. And next in verse 10, what we see is that Nehemiah applies the same standards to himself as he does to others. Anybody a wee bit more harsh with other people and how you judge how they should get on, as opposed to how you judge yourself and how you get on? I had a wee falling out with one of my daughters this week, and on reflection, blamed her, but on reflection, when I thought about it, I thought, actually, I was about 50-50. I was equally as culpable in this little argument as she was, but I had applied a different standard to her as I did myself. Do we do that? Well, Nehemiah doesn't. Nehemiah in this, he owns up. He says, look, I and my brothers and my men are also lending the people money and grain. But then he says, this is wrong. Let us stop charging interest. Nehemiah refuses to preach what he isn't practicing. He'd been lending to fellow Jews, albeit on good terms, but he had been lending to fellow Jews. And now when he sees the poverty trap that many of them are in, he says, this isn't right. We shouldn't be loaning them. We should be gifting them money. We need a different approach. Friends, the point is, like Nehemiah, we need to be humble and teachable in spirit so that when we seek to go to others and to deal with an issue and to confront an issue, we're also listening to God speaking to us about our part in it, and we're open to being changed by him as well as changing other people. Finally then, Nehemiah calls for reparations in verse 11. So he asks those who've been involved in this exploitation to give back to the people what they'd taken. He says, give back the fields, the vineyards, the olive groves, the houses. Also give back the interest you've been charging. He appeals to his compatriots and gives them a solution. So many times when we go to confront or talk to someone, we don't really give them an out. It's really important. I think the world could learn this with Putin. We need to give people an out. We need to give people somewhere they can go whenever we're trying to seek reconciliation and bring about peace. Same with us. When we go and talk to others, we need to come with a constructive suggestion to how do we sort things through. Real repentance involves as much as possible setting right. So if our misdeeds have caused harm to someone, confess it to God. And then if we have it in our power, try to make restitution to those we have hurt. Now, our efforts sometimes will be ignored or refused, but we should still do it because it's evidence that our repentance goes more beyond just lip service. It's actually from the heart. We really want to make things right again. I'll finish with this. The final verses of chapter 5, written by Nehemiah in summary years later. So we had Andy's bit, and then there are verses that are written after that. And Nehemiah reflects on this event, and he points to the two things that motivated him in all of this. He says, there were two things that motivated me in acting in this way. First of all, it was reverence for God. I did what I did because the verdict of heaven mattered most. In your dealings with others, does what God think matters most? Is the verdict of heaven uppermost in your mind? Do you try to live your life, as we've said before, for the glory of God to an audience of one? That's why Nehemiah behaved in this way. But then secondly, he says he was motivated by reverence for God and also by compassion for others. He bent over backwards to be a blessing rather than a burden. Is that how we try to interact with each other? That we bend over backwards to bless each other, bless those around us, rather than to be a burden and a hassle to them. Let's seek this week to live in this way where we love God and we love others. Let's be those who, as Paul writes, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. And when things get difficult between us, as they do in every group of people, let's respond holistically. Let's confront at source by appealing to people's better side. And let's apply the same standard to ourselves as we do to others. Let's also seek to put right what we do wrong. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you that your word is full of practical wisdom, Lord, and all of us struggle from time to time with other people. We fall out, we get annoyed, we get frustrated. But Lord, we pray for your Holy Spirit's help that we would live to try to honor you in everything we do, that we would live to try to bless and love others in everything we do also. And when things do crop up, we pray that we would take practical steps, that we wouldn't be those who encourage or through our passivity allow dissension and discord, but we would be those who take active steps to bring healing and wholeness in our relationships with each other. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to continue to pray using the form on page 238 of our prayer books, page 151 in the large print version. So it's page 238, page 151 in the large. Let's pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, you promised through your Son, Jesus Christ, to hear the prayers of those who ask in faith. Lord of your people, strengthen your church in all the world. Renew the life of this diocese of Down and Dromore. Bless David, our bishop, and build us up in faith and love. Lord of creation, look with favor on the world you have made. Guide the nations in the ways of justice and of peace. And we pray in particular for the people of Ukraine today. We pray for peace and the laying down of weapons. We pray for all those who fear for tomorrow, that your spirit of comfort would draw near to them. We pray for those with power over war or peace. We pray for wisdom and discernment and compassion to guide their decisions. And above all, we pray for all the innocents at risk, that you would hold and protect them. Closer to home, living God, we pray you would bless Elizabeth, our Queen, and all in authority. Lord of our relationships, comfort and sustain the communities in which we live and work. Help us to love our neighbors as ourselves. Enable us to serve our families and friends and to love one another as you love us. Lord of all healing, relieve and protect those who are sick or suffering. Be with those who have any special need, and in the silence, let's take a moment to pray for those who are on our heart this morning. Let's take a time of silent prayer. Lord of eternity, bind us together by your Holy Spirit in communion with all who, having confessed the faith, have died in the peace of Christ, that we may entrust ourselves and one another and our whole life to you, Lord God, and come with all your saints to the joys of your eternal kingdom. Amen. Let's turn together to the prayer of humble access, page 207 in our prayer books, page 131 in the large print. Pray with me. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. As we move into time of sharing the bread and the wine together, we're going to sing a communion hymn, hymn number 429, Lord Jesus Christ, Living Lord, 429. As we're able, we remain standing and turn to page 208 in our prayer books, page 132 in our large print version. Lord, yours is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For all things come from you, and of your own we give you. Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us. Today we use prayer 2, beginning on page 212, page 136. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. All glory and honor, thanks and praise be given to you at all times and in all places, Lord, Holy Father, true and living God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is your eternal word, through whom you have created all things from the beginning and formed us in your own image. In your great love, you gave him to be made man for us and to share our common life. He was tempted in every way as we are, yet he did not sin. And he gives us strength to control our desires and to walk in his way of love. In obedience to your will, your Son, our Savior, offered himself as a perfect sacrifice and died on the cross for our redemption. Through him, you have freed us from the slavery of sin and reconciled us to yourself, our God and Father. He is our great high priest, whom you raised from death and exalted to your right hand on high, where he ever lives to intercede for us. Through him, you have sent upon us your holy and life-giving Spirit and made us a royal priesthood called to serve you forever. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Merciful Father, we thank you for these gifts of your creation, for this bread and this wine, and we pray that all who eat and drink them in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, in obedience to our Savior Christ, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his body and his blood. Who in the night that he was betrayed took bread, and when he had given you thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, and again giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. So, Father, with this bread and this cup, we do as our Savior has commanded us. We celebrate the redemption he has won for us. We proclaim his perfect sacrifice made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and we look for his coming to fulfill all things according to your will. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Renew us by your Holy Spirit. Unite us in the body of your Son. And bring us with all your people into the joy of your eternal kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom by the power of the Holy Spirit we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of never-ending praise. Blessing and honor and glory and power are yours forever and ever. Amen. We continue on page 218 or page 142. And as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. Jesus Christ is the Lamb of God who has taken away the sins of the world. Happy are those who are called to his supper. Amen. Let's take our seats. In a moment or two, our wardens will invite you to come forward, but let me explain how we're going to do it. After I've served Andy, if you would like to participate in communion, if you come up in a single line, and I'll be standing to your left-hand side, if you could cup your hands and I'll use a tong to drop some bread into your hands, and then you can consume then before moving to your right, where you can receive one of the single cups from Andy. If you consume here, please, but then keep your cup and bring it back to your seat, we can dispose of those at the end of the service. Okay? So a single line, and then we move across one at a time, keeping each other safe. Lord God, you renew us with the living bread from heaven. Nourish our faith, increase our hope, strengthen our love, and enable us to live by every word that proceeds from out of your mouth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We continue from page 221, page 145 in our prayer books. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. I know we've overrun slightly today, but I would like to just share a few notices with us that are important before we go on our way with a closing prayer. So let me just return to my remote and share a few notices with you. A number of you have been asking, how can we respond to what's going on the other side of the world? Well, one of the ways you could respond is the Bishop's Appeal is giving money to two particular charities, to Habitat for Humanity and to Christian Aid, both of whom are working principally in the neighboring countries like Romania, Poland and stuff, where all the refugees have gone. But as soon as they can safely get money and resources to partners within country, they'll be doing that also. So if you want to support people who are actually doing work on the ground with those who are suffering on the back of what's happening with Russia, Ukraine, then you can do so as you leave today. There's a basket with a Ukrainian flag in front. You can put monies in there. So that's for Bishop's Appeal to go to Christian Aid and to Habitat for Humanity. On your way in, you should have got a little Lent book. I'll not dwell on it, but use it. It's a good resource. So have a go at using it this week. Daily reflections and thoughts on justice. Prayer club is happening Tuesday night. Do join us from 8 o'clock for half an hour in person or online. And Holy Communion will continue every Wednesday at 10 o'clock. From this Wednesday, we'll be meeting in the Jeffers room, so the room to the side. So we'll be meeting in there from this Wednesday. If you come in through the door on the car park and then go into the Jeffers room, 10 o'clock, Holy Communion in there. We had a great Andy's Anglican Angle, the first session 2 weeks ago. Was it 2 or 3 weeks? 2 weeks ago. To this week, we're going to have the second session where Andy's going to be thinking about the Eucharist. Really good, really engaging, really thought-provoking presentation and discussion first week. I'd invite you to come back, and we're going to be meeting in here so that we can observe things at the Holy Table. So it'll be here, 8 o'clock Wednesday night, for the second session of that. Men, Thursday, 11 o'clock, coffee at Orangefield Presbyterian. Everybody, if you've got wee ones in your family, invite them along to Tots Together on Friday. It's going great guns, which is good. We're going to start up coffee again from next week, and the hope is that there'll be coffee coming on through to when you arrive for your 11 o'clock service. So if you want, and I understand some won't, but if you would like a little refreshment as you come in, then that section will be closed off and you can have a coffee before coming in to worship. Primetimers is beginning at the end of this month. Great to have that going again. So if you're a senior and you want to get together for a bit of crack and fellowship, then March the 31st at 2 o'clock, Primetimers is starting up again. I know that a number of you know others who are involved in Primetimers. Could you get the word out and get them along? And anybody, they can go to another church, that's fine. They can go or not go to any church, that's fine. It's been really difficult this last 2 years for seniors. Invite them along. We'll do it safely, we'll do it well, but invite them along for Primetimers, March the 31st, 2 o'clock. Look, the rest of the notices I'm going to leave for now. Can we stand for our closing prayer, please? Go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast to Christ and to all that is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Instead, strengthen the faint-hearted. Help the afflicted. Honor all persons, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And as we do these things, may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you always. Amen. we go in peace to love and serve the Lord.